Thank you. That concludes general questions. The next item of business is First Minister's questions. I intend taking some constituency and general supplementaries after question two and some after question three. But members wishing to ask such supplementaries should press the request to speak buttons during question two. And I'll keep a note of members who press and may take further supplementaries at the end if we have time. And members wishing a supplementary on questions four to six, please press at the relevant question. Question number one, I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Every day in Scotland, four people lose their lives as a result of drug misuse. That's four lives every day cut needlessly short. Families mourning the loss of loved ones. Every single day in Scotland. This is a crisis. It is a national shame. The longer we wait, the longer we fail to act, the more lives will be lost. People are looking to this Parliament to deliver the solutions to halt this crisis and save lives. Today I published the Scottish Conservatives' Right to Recovery Bill to guarantee everyone who needs treatment for addiction can get it. I shared it earlier this morning with the First Minister. In June, she said she would look with an open mind at any proposals that are brought forward, including proposals for legislation. So will the First Minister commit to her government fully supporting our proposal to tackle Scotland's drug death crisis?
First Minister.
I will certainly repeat what I said before. When there is a bill, we will look at that very carefully. I have received the consultation this morning. I have an open mind on that. Just in point of fact, Presiding Officer, unless I am mistaken here, Douglas Ross, as I understand it, has not published a bill this morning. Indeed, the consultation that was sent to my office states at this stage there is no bill, only a draft proposal. Now, I'm not criticising that. It's important that legislation is properly consulted on. So we will consider the proposals in the consultation, and as and when that develops into actual proposed legislation, we will consider that in detail. What I would say, though, in addition to that, and perhaps it's a point of agreement, I do think speed of action now is essential. We all know that legislation takes time to go through the proper processes. Having looked briefly at the document that was sent to me this morning, it doesn't appear on the face of it to suggest anything that goes beyond what we are already doing, although it does suggest that those things should be enshrined in legislation. So if I take, for example, funding, part of the consultation regards the establishment of a new national funding scheme separate to ADPs. But it doesn't appear to be suggesting additional funding. For example, it says that what is proposed is well within the £50 million annual spending already being delivered. So we will continue with the action we have set out. We will continue to take that action. I don't think it is right to wait for legislation, but I repeat again, we remain open-minded to looking at the details of legislation when that comes from the consultation that has been published today.
Douglas Ross.
The First Minister will be aware I'm going through the very detailed process of the non-government bills unit, and I'm following the advice of parliamentary officials, which I'm very grateful for that they have provided to myself and the party. On the issue of funding, we know that the money currently being spent on this issue to try and save people's lives is not getting to those who need it most, which is why we are saying there are alternative ways to do it. And I hope the First Minister continues to be positive in her response to the consultation and the legislation that comes forward. But earlier this week, the First Minister proposed that we go on a joint visit, and she knows I immediately agreed to that offer. A key author of this bill and his colleague, the manager of Blue Vale Community Club in Hag Hill, have suggested that the First Minister and I visit them to see the need for a right to recovery. Volunteers at the club pointed out that it's in the second most deprived area in Scotland. People in places like Hag Hill are 18 times more likely to die from drugs than people in the most affluent areas. Blue Vale is trying to build a whole community, a whole system's response to the drugs crisis. This bill would help them get even more lives back on track. So will the First Minister agree to a joint visit with me to Blue Vale so we can find some common ground and get around the table with those on the front line to hear why this bill is so desperately needed?
First Minister.
I'll come to that point directly in a moment, but can I complete the point I addressed in my first answer? I was not, and I think I said explicitly, I was not criticising the process that Douglas Ross is going through, but in his initial question to me, he said, I think, that he had published a bill this morning, and I simply was making the point that's not the case. So we will consider the consultation, we will consider that fully and with an open mind, and then when that is translated, as I expect it will be in the fullness of time, into an actual bill, we will consider that in the normal parliamentary processes that all legislation goes through. I do have an open mind. I hope we can find maximum common ground. I suspect there will continue to be issues that divide us on the correct responses to the drugs crisis, but I hope none of us in this chamber allow those issues to get in the way of the areas where we can build agreement and consensus. On the issue of a visit, I'm glad that Douglas Ross accepted my suggestion earlier in the week that we go together to a working class community. My office will be in touch to take that forward shortly. I am certainly willing to meet with organisations and indeed with individuals, as I have previously, affected by drugs misuse. Of course, and I think this is an equally important point, Presiding Officer, and I hope it is one that will be accepted by Douglas Ross, the issues faced by working class communities go beyond drugs. Indeed, drug misuse can, in some cases, be a symptom of deeper issues, poverty, for example. So I'm sure Douglas Ross will agree with me that if we are to undertake such a joint endeavour, it will also be important to meet with, for example, those who have just had their universal credit withdrawn, driving them deeper into the poverty conditions that then sometimes lead to the other issues that we are talking about. So I look forward to finalising the details of that. I look forward to meeting with people who will no doubt have things to say about Scottish Government policy, about what we are doing, about what more they think we should do, but also people who are being deeply affected each and every day right now by UK Government policy that is doing a lot of damage in working class communities the length and breadth of the country.
Douglas Ross.
I'm grateful to the First Minister for that answer, and I give an unconditional acceptance to meet any community, anywhere, at any time, because this is an issue of national importance. I'm raising the issue about drugs deaths today because of the consultation I brought forward, and I know the First Minister has said this a couple of times. If I could just lay a bill right now, no, I think it's just important that everyone understands this. If I could lay a bill right now, I would. But the Non-Government Bills Unit, which the Parliament supports, sets out a very specific process for those not in government to go forward with. But we have heard from the Drugs Minister and others within the government that they were waiting to see our proposals. Our proposals are in the consultation document which was launched today. And this bill has been built by frontline experts like Favour Scotland. It has the backing of recovery groups across the country. One of those is... I'm sorry, this is a
Continue, Mr Ross.
Yeah, thank you, Presiding Officer. This is a really serious issue because I was saying what we are putting forward has been backed by recovery groups across the country. One of those is Recovery Enterprises in Kilmarnock. The founder, Mark Gallagher, says that people have, and these are his words, given up trying to access treatment because they see the system as broken. And that's why he believes we need to take forward the proposal I've launched today. Will the First Minister listen to these experts and, instead of delaying any longer, commit her government to backing our bill at stage one so that Parliament can properly scrutinise? Because the First Minister's concerns seem to be the lack of scrutiny. By saying right now that she would approve our proposals at stage one, would give Parliament the opportunity to look at them in detail.
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'm genuinely trying to be helpful and to build some agreement here. I've said twice, I understand the process Douglas Ross is going through. My comments are not meant to be a criticism. I would simply ask him, in return, to understand the proper and due process any responsible government has to go through in considering legislation. I cannot engage with a bill that doesn't yet exist for the reasons that we have heard. So we will engage with the proposals in the consultation. There is one that I, having looked at it briefly already this morning, would immediately welcome that, for example, when it comes to treatment, the consultation seems to recognise that we need a range of different interventions and services and that there can't be a one-size-fits-all approach. I actually think that is a welcome step forward from the Conservatives, who previously have appeared to suggest that only residential rehabilitation was a solution here. So already I can see the emergence of some common ground, and I genuinely want to treat this with the respect it deserves. But equally, Douglas Ross must know that I cannot stand here and say carte blanche that I will vote for a bill when, by his own admission, for understandable reasons, the bill does not yet exist. So let's try and move forward here with a genuine determination to build consensus where we can. The last point I would make is one that I've made earlier. There is a real need here to move forward at pace. With the best will in the world, and I think we're demonstrating this here today, legislation takes time, and it takes time for good reason. I don't want to wait for legislation, however merited legislation may or may not turn out to be. I don't want to wait for that. We have set out a very detailed plan of action backed by significant additional resources that has as its heart guaranteed standards of treatment, including access to same-day treatment. So we're going to get on with that. And then if we think as a parliament that legislation can help to underpin that in the future, as I've said many times, I am open-minded to that. But if we want to build that consensus, let's both understand the processes that we have to go through in order, hopefully, in the interests of people across the country, that we can get there.
Douglas Ross.
And I think, you know, that is a fair comment, but stage one of a bill is agreeing the general principles. And the First Minister has already looked at some of the principles we are putting forward. She's already looked at the issues around funding. She's already looked at the areas where there is agreement. And while there seems to be opposition from her backbenches, I'm more encouraged by her response than I've heard from those behind her. Because our proposal is also supported by grieving families. And if SNP members want to talk over grieving families, then shame on them. Because I want to give a case about Vicky. Vicky has lost two brothers to drugs. She lost Stuart just last year. He was a father of twins. He was only 43, and Stuart came from a loving family. Vicky said he tried to get treatment, but, and I quote her words, he was moved from pillar to post. He was passed about the system. He was treated like he didn't matter. Vicky is backing our proposals. She can't know for sure that it would have saved Stuart, but she told us, if we had this bill, I wonder how many people would still be here. The First Minister was absolutely right to say that we have to move forward at pace. So will she listen to the experts, the grieving families and the proposals we're bringing forward and ensure that there is urgent parliamentary time given to consider the proposals on such an urgent issue?
First Minister.
I am genuinely... And I think Douglas Ross has accepted this. I'm genuinely trying not to make this exchange a politically divisive one, because I think we all agree. We perhaps don't agree on all of the detail of this. We certainly don't necessarily agree on all of the background to this. But I think we do agree that this Parliament, and I certainly accept that this government, has got much work to do. Let me try and make some progress here. I can't agree to vote for a bill that doesn't yet exist, because I don't know what that bill in detail is going to say. But on the look, and I only received the consultation this morning, I've had the chance to have a brief look at it. I will study it in more detail. But if the broad sort of proposals there translate into the general principles of a bill, I think it would be likely that we would want to give that bill a fair wind through Parliament to see whether on the detail we can reach consensus. Now, I think any reasonable person, when we're talking about a bill that is not yet in existence, would think that is not an unreasonable response for a First Minister who has a duty to make sure we go through all the right processes as well to give. So I hope we can sort of agree that that is a reasonable starting point. And then on the fact that we have a duty, and it's a duty I feel very, very strongly, to make sure that what hasn't worked well in our drug treatment services in the past is rectified for the future. We have an obligation to make sure that we are listening to lived experience and that we're using that lived experience to drive proposals. My condolences and you know, my sympathies are with Vicky on the loss of Stuart and with every other family that has lost someone to drugs. They are the ones that we must keep in mind. But part of keeping them in mind and part of living up to our responsibility to them is making sure that we are thinking seriously about what has to be done. And that as we are considering, because we are demonstrating today and the time it takes, understandably, to even get a draft bill before Parliament, that legislation takes time, that we are moving on with various things now. And that's the commitment that the Government has given and will continue to take forward.
Point of order, Christine Graham.
I just seek clarification, Presiding Officer. My objections when Douglas Ross was speaking from a sedentary position were that he seemed to be trying to bypass the non-governmental bills unit processes, which we all have to go through, which is a proposal, consultation, then a bill laid. And I seek clarification from these exchanges. Is Mr Ross trying to bypass the other members have to go through?
I thank Ms Graham for her point of order. The member and other members will be well aware of the processes that a bill has to go through, and that will apply in this case as it would to any other bill. And I take Anna Sarwar, question number two.
2 years ago, I stood in this chamber and revealed what brave NHS whistleblowers had uncovered about water contamination at the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital in Glasgow. It was met with denial, delay and attempts to bully in silence by the Health Board. 2 years on, we've had a discredited independent review, a case note review, the commencement of a public inquiry and ongoing police investigations. Every step of the way, we have had to fight the system to bit by bit, piece by piece, uncover the truth. Thanks to the case note review, we know that two children's deaths were linked to hospital infections. There is now a criminal investigation into one of those deaths, Millie Main. But the Health Board only referred Millie's case to the Crown when Millie's family applied for a fatal accident inquiry. They didn't take the opportunity then to refer the second child, and they didn't take the opportunity when the case note review was published. I met with the Crown. They didn't know the details of the second child and had to ask me to provide those details, again thanks to the bravery of whistleblowers. That case note review was commissioned by the Scottish Government. Why wasn't that child's death reported for investigation?
First Minister.
These are really serious matters that the Government has and continues to take seriously. The Government commissioned the independent review. I don't accept that it is a discredited independent review, but the Government also accepted that there had to be further process in order to ensure that parents and families affected by what had happened at the Queen Elizabeth Hospital was fully and properly investigated. So this Government established the public inquiry, which is now underway, and that inquiry will take its course and is completely independent of government and indeed, of course, of Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board. As Anna Sarwar has also said, there is a live police investigation into some of the cases that have been discussed in this chamber before. For all of these reasons, it would not be right, appropriate or indeed helpful to the families concerned for me to get further into the detail of any of these cases, given the processes, the independent processes that are underway. But I want to leave no one, as I have done before, in any doubt about how seriously I take these issues, how seriously the Government takes these issues, and how determined we are through the processes we have established in the form of the public inquiry to get to the answers, to get to the truth, and then all of us, as a Parliament, of course, will have the opportunity to reflect on those findings and consider what further action is necessary.
Anna Sarwar.
I thank the First Minister for that answer, but I think she misses a fundamental issue here, which is this is still campaigners, families and whistleblowers having to take on the system to get answers around the system working in their favour. Because at the heart of this are grieving families. We know that one of the families hadn't been told the truth about why their child died and hadn't been contacted. The First Minister gave this chamber a personal commitment that every effort would be made to contact that family. So I would appreciate an update on progress with that. But there is a fundamental issue here. In one case, Millie's family is fighting for answers. They now have a criminal investigation into her death. The other family has been kept in the dark, and up until now, there has been no criminal investigation into their child's death. These cases shouldn't be treated differently. It shouldn't take a family publicly fighting for answers. That's not acceptable. There should have been criminal investigations launched into both deaths as soon as the circumstances became clear. So why, First Minister, is it still falling to whistleblowers, families and campaigners to do the job of the Health Board and the job of the Scottish Government for them?
First Minister.
I simply don't think that I have the greatest of respect for whistleblowers. I have the greatest respect and obviously the greatest of sympathy for the families, and I would absolutely not hesitate to say that. But I go again to the point I made earlier on. It was this government, it was the previous Health Secretary, Jean Freeman, who commissioned and established the public inquiry. The public inquiry is now underway. There are criminal investigations underway. It is not up to me what cases are investigated from a criminal perspective and which are not. Rightly, that is not up to me. That is up to the police and the Crown Office. And I know, and again, just as in the previous, I think it's important to try not to divide on these issues, but to recognise the actions in this case of Anas Sawa. I know he cares deeply about the families involved here, and that's why I also know he will recognise, at least I hope he recognises, that the worst thing I could do, standing here as First Minister right now, in light of the independent processes that are underway, a statutory public inquiry and criminal investigations, would be for me to in any way inadvertently prejudice either of these processes by getting further into the detail of this right now. We've done what I think is the right thing to establish the independent inquiry. It is entirely for the police and the Crown Office to determine what criminal investigations are undertaken. I think it is incumbent on all of us who do take these issues seriously, who want to get to the answers here, that we allow these processes to take their course. And then, of course, when we have the findings of them, this Parliament will have not just the opportunity, but a duty to reflect on any further action that is necessary.
Anas Sarwar.
I know the First Minister didn't give an update on the progress in finding the family, and I would appreciate that in response to this question. But I think she's also missing the fundamental point that it shouldn't take a family having to campaign in a newspaper in order to get a child's death investigated. That's fundamentally what's happened here. The reason why Millie Main's death is being investigated is because of the bravery of Kimberly Darroch to go onto the television and speak in a newspaper about what happened to her daughter. The other family doesn't have the opportunity to do that because they don't know what happened to their child. That cannot be a reason not to have a criminal investigation into that child's death. Now, months ago, I asked the First Minister to help find the family. And years ago, I asked her to hold the Health Board to account. And every time we ask them to take action, little happens. Every bit of progress has been fought for by the families and the campaigners. I note what she says about the public inquiry. That public inquiry was hard fought and won by the families and the campaigners, frankly, not by the government. Nicola Sturgeon was Health Secretary when the hospital was commissioned. She was First Minister when the hospital was opened and has been in charge throughout this scandal. Surely there must come a point when it stops being whistleblowers, families and campaigners taking on the state in order to get answers, and instead the state takes the side of the whistleblowers, families and campaigners to find the answers and get justice. Because we can't wait for the outcome of the public inquiry for families to get justice. That could take years. Words of sympathy from the First Minister are frankly wearing thin. What is it going to take for Nicola Sturgeon to take responsibility, own this crisis, get a grip of this rotten Health Board and get the families the truth and the justice they deserve?
First Minister.
Sorry, before I go on to that question, I apologise for not addressing the point about the efforts to trace the second family. The last time Anas Sarwar asked about this, set out the steps that the Health Board had taken to try to locate the family. As I understand it, they have not located the family. As I absolutely understand it, that is not for the want of trying and effort, and that appropriate steps will continue to be taken. On the issue of criminal investigations, and this is a fundamental point of constitutional democracy. It is not up to the First Minister of the country at any time, whoever he or she may be, to determine what cases are and are not subject to criminal investigation. It would be deeply improper if that was the case. And on the question Anas Sarwar just posed to me again, a government that has established a full, independent, statutory public inquiry cannot be said to be a government that is somehow trying to hide away from getting to the truth. We want the answers. in order that if there are issues to be addressed with the Health Board, they can be addressed. If there are issues around government policy, they can be addressed. And fundamentally, so that the families, the most important thing of all, get the answers that they want. But it is not credible for Anas Sarwar to say that a public inquiry was fought for and campaigned for, and I accept that, although the government did establish the public inquiry, and then in the next breath just to say, well, it doesn't matter, we can't wait for that, we have to somehow do something different. This is an independent statutory public inquiry. Those who have a genuine interest in getting to the answers and the truth now, I think, have a duty to allow that inquiry to properly do its work. That's what the government is going to do, and I would suggest that that is what Anas Sarwar needs to do as well.
I call Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister will be aware of the Prime Minister's outrageous and condescending response on the Andrew Marr Show and others regarding the cull and incineration of pigs which should have gone into our food system. Does she agree with me that this waste is unacceptable, as is the financial and emotional toll on the farmers involved, and that having a robust supply chain is completely undermined by a lack of a trained workforce?
First Minister.
Yes, I do. I do think it was deeply regrettable that the Prime Minister treated the very serious issues of animal welfare with such disdain on Sunday, just as I think it was outrageous that he made an entire speech to his party conference yesterday and didn't mention the fact that on that very day his government had taken away £20 a week from the poorest families across the country. In terms of the specific issue Jim Fairley raises, the government is monitoring this very carefully. At the heart of it is labour shortages, which are impacting on many sectors of our economy. Those labour shortages have been significantly exacerbated by the ending of freedom of movement that came about because of Brexit. We will do what we can through employability and skills work to try to address that, but fundamentally the answers and the solutions have to lie with the UK Government, and I would call on them to take urgent action to make sure that these problems that are being experienced already do not get even worse as the winter progresses.
I call Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There have been long-standing issues with mental health treatment in my region. It is therefore troubling to learn of reports of inappropriate admission of children under 18 into adult psychiatric wards. First Minister, it is vital that young people with often complex needs get the help they need and deserve. Therefore, what action will the Scottish Government put in place to address these failings?
First Minister.
It is important that everybody who needs mental health treatment gets that treatment in the best possible setting. I think that is particularly important when we're talking about children and adolescents. The government is already taking a range of actions to further develop community wellbeing services for children and young people, and, for example, providing counsellor funding for counsellors in schools so that there is much earlier intervention for young people and that more of them do not require the services of more specialist provision. So there's a range of work underway here which will continue to progress with additional funding over the months to come.
Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yesterday, an employment tribunal upheld former police officer Rona Malone's claims of victimisation against Police Scotland. The judgment was damning. It found that the firearms unit in which she served was an, and I quote, absolute boys' club, and the culture was horrific. It also found evidence provided by officers from the Professional Standards Department, the department responsible for investigating complaints within the police, as implausible and wholly unsatisfactory. Now, I'm sure the First Minister, like me, has huge respect for the work that police do both locally and nationally. However, I'm concerned that this experience of Ms Malone is not unique. In recent years, I've been approached by female officers raising issues regarding culture, out-of-hours behaviour, deployment rotas and equipment. Their complaints often being lost in a system that is difficult and stressful to navigate, ultimately leading to those officers resigning from the force rather than pursuing their complaints. I know Rona McLean, I've spoken to her, so can I ask the First Minister to join me in commending her for her bravery in pursuing her complaint? And in light of the Sarah Everard issues, does she feel that there is a need for a fuller investigation and inquiry into the culture and practice within Police Scotland regarding sexism and misogyny?
First Minister.
Well, firstly, can I take the opportunity to pay tribute to Rona Malone and to say how deeply troubling I think the findings of the tribunal were, and I would commend her bravery in taking that case. The findings, though, do paint a picture that should trouble all of us, and I think it's really important that in confronting these issues, as we all must do, that we do not consider that any case like this, or do not assume that any case like this is necessarily an isolated incident. And secondly, that we do not assume that any organisation in our society, however well respected that organisation is by all of us, is somehow immune from the misogynistic culture that pervades our whole society. So the findings of this tribunal must be taken seriously, and I welcome the response of Police Scotland yesterday to accept the findings and express its seriousness in addressing these issues. More generally, though, this is a further reminder, and there have been too many painful reminders of this in recent weeks, that on the spectrum of unacceptable experiences on the part of women, and it is a spectrum that goes from inappropriate comments through to discrimination in the workplace, through to violence and serious sexual assault. Behind all of the behaviours, experiences rather, on that spectrum, lies unacceptable behaviour on the part of men. And that is the problem that has to be addressed and has to be rectified. Now, I am old enough and have seen, and you know, like all women, at some stage of that spectrum, I've experienced this over the years. So I don't say this lightly, because you know, it's taken too long to get to this point. But I hope we are finally at a watershed moment and a turning point where we stop expecting women to fix these problems, and we put the full glare where it belongs on men who behave in a deeply unacceptable and misogynistic way. And I would say to all men in this chamber and all men across the country, challenge it if it's on the part of other men that you know. Challenge your own behaviour, and then let's collectively as a society turn the page and turn the corner so that women can live free of the fear of harassment, abuse, intimidation, violence, and in the worst cases, death.
Question number three, Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister when the Cabinet will next meet.
First Minister.
Tuesday.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful for that reply. Muscle spasms, chronic fatigue, diarrhoea, air hunger to the point of gasping for breath. Figures released today show that 79,000 people in Scotland are now living with long COVID. It could be the biggest mass disabling event since the end of the First World War. The Scottish Government's initial intervention could only help 60 people a month, which is why the much-delayed long COVID plan published last week should have been transformative. But I've spoken today with a constituent who suffers from long COVID. He was, in his words, devastated to discover that nothing has changed. Now, I have warned before that people with the condition are better off moving to England, where there are well-established clinics and a care pathway, and nothing in this document will match that. Long COVID Scotland have been trying to meet the Health Secretary, but he has refused them at every turn. If he hasn't met them, how can he possibly know what they need? So will the First Minister either meet them herself or instruct her Health Secretary to do so at the earliest possibility?
First Minister.
I believe the Health Secretary has met with long COVID patients, and I'm sure he would be more than willing to meet with others. This is a serious issue, and one that we are going to be living with the impact of for some time. I'm not going to comment, because I'm not an expert on the arrangements south of the border. I do suspect they don't always live up to how they are talked about here in some of the detail, but that is another matter. We have published the long COVID strategy that Alec Cole-Hamilton refers to. There are 16 different commitments in that. All of those commitments are backed by a £10 million funding commitment. And part of that is to further our understanding of the reasons for and the implications of long COVID, so that the services that are then developed are properly addressing that. There's nothing to stop health boards establishing specialist provision right now, but what we also want to do is make sure that through all of the more generalist NHS provision, clinicians are are capable of addressing the impacts of long COVID as they are presented. So again, this is an issue that is serious now, and it's going to continue to be an obligation on the part of government, which is why the commitments in that paper are so important.
I call Bob Doris.
Fire of heat alarms in Scottish homes by February 2022. Is the First Minister aware that several retailers are still selling the previous generation of smoke and heat alarms which cannot be interlinked and cannot meet the new standards that are being brought in? Does she agree with me that such stores should be clear with customers about the February 2022 regulations ahead of any purchase being made? And can I ask if there will be any support for homeowners struggling to pay for the cost of installing such smoke and heat alarms?
Can I ask if the First Minister contends that you heard enough of the question, First Minister?
I think so, Presiding Officer. My apologies to Bob Doris. I missed the start of the question. The sound couldn't be heard here in the chamber, but I think I got the general thrust of it. These are obviously important issues ahead of the expected demand for smoke alarms ahead of the 1st of February next year, when the new standard is due to come into force. There's significant public interest because of the public awareness campaign, but we do know that some retailers may have short-term supply issues. We have, though, been assured by manufacturers that there is a sufficient supply of alarms available to meet that expected demand. We will continue to consider whether there is more we need to do to support homeowners, be compliant with that standard, and take a range of actions should we consider that that is necessary. But the public awareness campaign was important in making sure people have that increased understanding of what will be expected as of February next year.
Call Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A report published by the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service for Scotland reported 33,425 charges of domestic abuse in 2020-21. Now, that suggests on average 91 incidents of domestic abuse every day in Scotland, the highest level since 2015. And that's only the number of reported cases. Now, I know the First Minister has taken interest in this unacceptable situation. So can I ask the First Minister if she will agree that the Scottish Government needs to review policies currently in place, and will she also investigate the establishment of family violence courts?
First Minister.
We'll consider any reasonable proposal. I know the new Lord Advocate, who, as people will know from her background, has a very strong interest in ensuring that victims of domestic abuse and women who are victims of male violence get appropriate and speedy access to justice. And I know she is very keen to ensure that all of the Crown Office policies and procedures are helping to ensure that that is the case. It is, we obviously have commented on the underlying driving reasons for domestic abuse and violence against women and girls, but where women and girls do experience that, and while some men, of course, experience domestic abuse, and it's important to recognise that, the majority are women, that the justice system responds appropriately. The numbers, while they are deeply troubling, anybody being victims of those crimes is deeply troubling, but of course we've got to remember that increases in numbers may mean that people now feel more able to come forward and support these crimes, which is something we should welcome. And of course this Parliament, to its great credit, passed a new law making certain behaviour that wasn't previously criminal in terms of coercive and controlling abuse. So we've got to bear those things in mind when we're looking at the numbers. But making sure people have access to justice is an important part of this overall approach to reducing the impact of domestic abuse and violence on women.
Question number four, Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister, in light of this being Libraries Week, what the Scottish Government's response is to reports that some libraries remain closed.
First Minister.
But Libraries Week is an opportunity to celebrate the contribution libraries make to our communities. A small number of libraries across the country have not yet reopened after the COVID closures. There are a number of reasons for this, I understand, including the fact that some are still being used as COVID test centres, some are co-located within schools, or in some cases there is a requirement for refurbishment before reopening. However, I hope that most of the others will reopen soon. I can say, though, that of the 481 libraries across Scotland, 432 of them are open as of Monday, and a further 24 have announced reopening dates that will be forthcoming. So well over 90% of all libraries across the country are already open, and I think that's something we should welcome. In the programme for government, of course, we announced our £1.25 million public library COVID support fund, which is intended to give local authorities and libraries support in getting open again and staying open, because libraries are a vital and integral part of communities across our country.
Christine Graham.
I thank the First Minister for a detailed response. Many libraries are indeed open, though some on reduced hours, including in Midlothian, South Tweeddale and Lauderdale. But does the First Minister agree with Pamela Tulloch, Chief Executive of Scottish Libraries and Information Council, which administers that welcome £1.25 million Libraries Recovery Fund targeted at libraries in areas of deprivation, that this helps, but part of the problem has been the Council's understandable redeployment during COVID of staff elsewhere? And therefore, does she agree with me that as we move out of COVID, full staffing of libraries should again be possible, and therefore all libraries fully open?
First Minister.
Yes, I do agree with that. I think it is important. I think everybody recognises, or everybody who has been reasonable, recognises the impact of COVID, not just on libraries, but on many of the other services that local authorities deliver. So there is a period of getting back to normal, of reconfiguring services that had to be reconfigured going into COVID. But it is important that libraries can fully reopen unless there is a very good reason, a need for refurbishment, for example, or being used as a test centre where that cannot happen. Because libraries are important to give people, young people in particular, access to books. It was access to a library that fueled my own love of reading when I was younger. That is vitally important. But these days, libraries are used for many other things as well, and it's important that that community provision is there, which is why in Glasgow, where my own constituency is, the vast majority of libraries are open again, and that is welcome, as is the case across the country. But it's important that we support councils to get the remaining ones open as quickly as possible.
Question number five, Megan Gallagher.
To ask the First Minister whether the Scottish Government will review the implementation date for changes to allow parents to defer their child's start at primary school.
First Minister.
Of course, entry to school can be deferred if a child is not yet five on the first day of primary school. Not all deferred children are yet automatically entitled to a funded place in early years education. However, we have introduced new legislation to guarantee funding for early learning and childcare during any deferred year. This legislation will come into force from August 2023. And that is in a timetable that has already been approved by Parliament. There are no plans to change this timetable because it has been developed in partnership with COSLA so that it is realistic and achievable. In the meantime, we've already committed £3 million to fund five authorities to deliver in 2021-22 as part of a pilot programme to support wider rollout of that commitment. And the Minister for Children and Young People will shortly announce additional pilot authorities for 2022-23.
Megan Gallagher.
Despite legislation being approved by Parliament, parents are still being refused the right to defer their child's school start. Indeed, the Scottish Government have opted for a trialled approach, meaning that it's become a postcode lottery whether a council will grant permission for a child to start school 1 year later. School deferrals were not even mentioned as part of the Scottish Government's recovery plan. First Minister, why has the full implementation date been delayed until 2023? And will the Scottish Government commit to bringing this date forward so all parents have the same rights to make the best possible decision for their child's education?
First Minister.
Well, on the issue of the August 2023 implementation date, I appreciate the member wasn't in Parliament when that was agreed, but that implementation date of August 2023 was agreed by Parliament on the 3rd of February 2021. And unless I am mistaken, it was supported by all Conservative members of Parliament at that time. And the reason for that is a pragmatic one. We have to work with COSLA to make sure that date is achievable and that it is deliverable, and that was the consensus that was reached and, as I say, backed by Parliament. Along the way, we are piloting, as I said in my initial answer, a number of local authorities to deliver on that commitment and to support the wider rollout. I understand parents want that to happen straight away, and I understand the reasons for that, but we're doing this in the proper way so that it is deliverable, it is properly delivered, and all children, when we get to that implementation date, should they want to defer or should their parents want to defer their entry to primary school, will have that right.
Question number 6, Martin Whitfield.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government's response is to the announcement that the SQA has entered a 2-year agreement with the Equality and Human Rights Commission to improve equalities practices. After the Commission established, the SQA was not routinely assessing the impact of its policies and practices against the three needs of the public sector equality duty.
First Minister.
Well, the Education Secretary met with the Chief Executive of the SQA earlier this week and impressed upon her the need to deliver against this Section 23 agreement. The EHRC's findings refer to historic omissions at the SQA. Learners can be assured that all required equality impact assessments regarding the awarding of national qualifications over the past 2 years were completed and published indeed by the SQA and the Scottish Government. I welcome SQA's action plan and their commitment to completing outstanding equality impact assessments for all of their current policies and practices, with 28 new equality impact assessments already published since August.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm grateful. The First Minister spent the whole of the last Parliament telling us that it was education. Education was her number one priority. One of the causes of the attainment gap she claims her government are working so hard to close is infamously inequality. So can she tell me, if it was her absolute priority, why did she never think to ask her own education governing body, were they looking at the question of equality?
First Minister.
What? I would expect the SQA and all bodies, whether they're government agencies or otherwise, to have quality at the heart of everything they do. That's been impressed upon the SQA, as I said in my opening answer. As I also said, this finding of the EHRC refers to historic emissions. So over the last period, indeed, since the current chief executive was appointed, any new SQA policy or practice that has been introduced has been subject to an equality impact assessment in line with duties under the Equalities Act. So the SQA is right now to go back and make sure that that applies to all current policies and practices, and the government expects them fully to do so in line with their action plan.
Thank you. That concludes First Minister's questions. We will now move on to members' business.